गुरुरेव गतिः गुरुमेव भजे गुरुणैव सहास्मि नमो गुरवे न गुरोः परमं शिशुरस्मि गुरोर्मतिरस्ति गुरौ मम पाहि गुरो। राम राम राम। सो सिंस पास्ट सेवरल वीक्स वी हैव बीन डिस्कसिंग सूक्त रत्नानि एंड पर्टिकुलरली सूक्त रत्नानि इन डिटेल वी हैव बीन डिस्कसिंग अबाउट द वर्क एंड द ऑथर एटसेट्रा। सो वी हैव कंप्लीटेड प्रोबेबली 7 of the Sukta Ratnani, and today we'll be going to the 8th one. So again, as before, we will first see from which particular grantha it is taken from, who is the author, and discuss a little bit more in detail about that. So today the Sukta Ratnani we have chosen is the 7th one. So again, we will first go into the Kriti, the Karta, the poet, and then we will go into where this particular Sukti comes into picture. So the 7th Sukta Ratnani. So we have completed 1 to 6 and 9th one. So we are doing the 7th one as of now. So this particular Sukta Ratnani is taken from, does anyone know from where it is taken? Okay. So this is taken from Kalidasa's Raghuvamsham. So already we have discussed a very beautiful work of Kalidasa. Actually, we have discussed 2 beautiful works of Kalidasa. The very first one was Abhijnana Shakuntalam. And then we discussed Kumara Sambhavam. And today we are discussing about Raghuvamsham. So as we have already discussed about Kalidasa twice, no further detail. Of course, any amount of explanation I give about Kalidasa is less. But still, we have already discussed several details about the life of Kalidasa, where he lived, what are his works. And luckily, we have a third Kriti of Kalidasa, that is Raghuvamsham, that we are discussing today. So let us not go into the details of Kalidasa. We'll look a little more into the works of Kalidasa. This particular work. And again, similar to Kumara Sambhava, I would like to take a little more time to go a little more in detail about Raghuvamsha, because being one of the most famous Kritis in Sanskrit literature, it is my privilege to give you more details about it. So we will take probably 2 or 3 classes for Raghuvamsha. Okay. So now, as I've told you, even when discussing Kumara Sambhava, Malavikagnimitra was probably the starting point of Kalidasa's literary career. It was his first work, and Kumara Sambhava was probably his last work. And I had given you several reasons why Kumara Sambhava could have been the last Kriti of Kalidasa. Now, Raghuvamsha is the next Kriti that we are discussing. As I've told you, Kalidasa has written 2 Mahakavyas, Kumara Sambhava and Raghuvamsha, 2 Khandakavyas, Ritu Samhara and Meghadutam, and 3 Natakas, Malavikagnimitra, Abhijnana Shakuntalam and Vikramorvashiyam. So Raghuvamsha comes under Mahakavya. And one more fact that people believe is probably this work is the first Mahakavya of Kalidasa. So I've already told you that Kumara Sambhava is the last Kriti of Kalidasa, and I've given reasons. So that surely makes Raghuvamsha the previous Mahakavya. But I have certain reasons that I still want to give you why this work, Raghuvamsha, probably is the first Mahakavya of Kalidasa. So we'll discuss that later. First, I would like to tell you about Mahakavyas. So I've already told you in Kumara Sambhava also. So literature divides Kritis into Mahakavyas, Khandakavyas, etc. based on certain rules. For example, the storyline for a Mahakavya should be mythology or something inspired by Itihasa, history. Secondly, the hero should be a very prominent hero from, you know, history or Itihasa or Puranas. And he should be a very brave king or brave person. The rasa, the navarasas, we know Shanta, Bhibatsa, Raudra, Shringar, all these. So only a few types of rasas can be used as the main theme of Mahakavya. Shringar rasa, Veera rasa and Shanta rasa. These 3 rasas are only possible to be considered in Mahakavya's concept. I will tell you some very prominent Mahakavyas that we have in Sanskrit literature, and then we will go into a little more detail. So of course, Valmiki's Ramayana is the first Adikavya, and it's also considered a Mahakavya. Vyasa's Mahabharata is also a Mahakavya. Raghuvamsha, Kumara Sambhava, written by Kalidasa. Buddha Charitam and Saundarananda, written by Ashwaghosha. Bharavi's Kiratarjuniya. Magha's Shishupalavatha. Sriharsha's Naishadhiya Charitam. So these are the 9 most prominent Kritis, Mahakavyas, written in Sanskrit. And I've told this in chronological order. So first Ramayana came, then Mahabharata came. And after that, all the Kavis we know have come. And already we can see that while Valmiki wrote just one Mahakavya, Vyasa wrote just one Mahakavya, Kalidasa was able to write two Mahakavyas in his lifetime. So that itself puts him in the prominent position in Sanskrit literature. And it is an understood fact among literary critics that Kalidasa is probably the foremost, like Kalidasa's Mahakavyas are the foremost. That is, Raghuvamsham and Kumarasambhavam are the first and second most famous and most prominent Mahakavya. So he has even surpassed Vyasa and Valmiki in writing the Mahakavya.
And prominent. Anna, I have a question.
Yeah.
Isn't Ramayana also called as Adi Kavya?
Yes, Ramayana is the Adi Kavya and it comes under the category of Mahakavya. So, already we can see that by writing two Mahakavyas, Kalidasa has shown us his greatness. Because while Vyasa and Valmiki only could write one Mahakavya in their lifetime, Kalidasa has given us two beautiful Mahakavyas. Hence, that itself takes Kalidasa to a very great level. So, these were some Mahakavyas and how prominent Kalidasa has become by writing two Mahakavyas. Now, coming to Raghuvamsha as is, that work that we are discussing for today. Raghuvamsha consists of 19 sargas. So as I've told you, even Kumarasambhava was divided into sargas. Even Raghuvamsha is divided into sargas. So there are 19 sargas in Raghuvamsha. What is this story about? As the name itself tells, Raghuvamsha, the story of the clan of Suryavamsha starting from Dilipa. So he has taken a part of Suryavamsha, which is called Raghuvamsha, and he has described in detail about each and every person, each and every king, starting right from Dilipa until the last known famous ruler of Raghuvamsha. So Suryavamsha, the name came because it originated from Vivaswan Surya. So Raghuvamsha is, so since Raghu was a very prominent king in Suryavamsha, the people who came after him were all called Raghavas. Even Rama is a Raghava, Dasharatha is a Raghava, Ajay is a Raghava, and Lavakusha are also Raghava. So since Raghu attained such a prominent place in Suryavamsha, his further descendants are called Raghuvamsha. So this story, Raghuvamsham, is based on the story or the life of these kings who came after Dilipa. Now, one more thing that you should understand is, as I've told you, what kavis do is, they take the original work written by some other kavi and they beautify it. So, I know Kalidasa took the small incident of Dushyanta and Shakuntala and made it into a very beautiful work called Abhijnana Shakuntalam. He took the very small incident of the birth of Kartikeya and made it Kumarasambhavam. Similarly, he has taken a very improminent part of Ramayana, wherein, so when during the marriage of Rama, Vasishta, the Kulaguru, would have come and done something called Shakochara. Shakochara is nothing but telling or, you know, describing the previous rulers of that Vamsha. So that is the, you know, custom that is done, wherein once a person, a new king, is being married to a queen, the Kula Guru comes and tells about the previous rulers who have brought fame. So that is called Shakochara. So whatever Shakochara that Vasishta did, Kalidasa has not performed, used that exactly. He has, you know, taken some other sources of information and he has done modifications to beautify it. So he does not follow the exact names of the kings who came in the Shakochara told by Vasishta. He has taken a slightly different approach, gathering information from other sources. Now, what he does in Raghuvamsha is, he takes each prominent king, starting from Dilipa, he explains their beautiful qualities, how, you know, what were their good qualities, how were their ruling capabilities, how were they to physically look, everything. He then tells about how the kingdom was. So under every king, the kingdom sees some change. For example, in Rama, when Rama was there, the, you know, place where he was ruling was called Rama Rajya. It became an idol for ruling. So something similar he'll tell. So under this kingdom, these were the things that happened and how this particular king ruled, were the citizens happy, what were the good things he did to the citizens, all he tells. And he also takes some very good anecdotes or some very important incidents in the life of prominent Raghuvamsha kings and explains them in detail. Some of these come in Ramayana, but some of these are like Loka Kathas. They are not prominent, but they are folklores that are told about each and every king. So that is what is the prime Katha Vastu of Raghuvamsha. Now, the main kings that Kalidasa speaks about in Raghuvamsha is, first is Dilipa, second is his son Raghu, third is Raghu's son Aja, Aja's son Dasharatha, Dasharatha's son Rama, and Rama's son Lavakusha. So these are some of the prominent kings about whom Kalidasa has taken time to explain in detail. But after this, whoever come, he has taken just small, you know, he has taken a very small amount of time to explain about them. Now, as I've told you, first Kavya to be written is Ramayana, Adi Kavya, and it was also the first Mahakavya. So, if you see the Sukti Ratnani, I actually felt bad that there is no shloka or there is no Sukti Ratnani from Ramayana. So, I thought, okay, I won't be able to talk about Ramayana. But luckily, Raghuvamsha has a part which describes Ramayana in Sankshipta Rupa. And I'm very, very happy that at least through this Raghuvamsha, I can tell you a little bit about Ramayana as well. How these sargas are divided is what I will tell next. So, in the first and second sarga, so as I've told you, there are 19 sargas. So, in the first and second sarga, it's a complete description about the life of Dilipa. Sarga number 3, 4 and 5 is given to Raghu because he is the main prominent person. We are talking about Raghu Vamsha. So the person who got this clan, this name Raghu, should be given prominence. So 3, 4 and 5th sarga are dedicated to Raghu. Sarga number 6, 7 and 8 are describing Aja and his wife Indumati. Sarga number 9 is about Dasharatha. Sarga number 10 to Sarga number 15 is complete life of Rama, which is nothing but Ramayana. Then from Sarga number 16 till the end, Sarga number 19, it describes the next descendants of Rama. That is Lava, Kusha and their next successors are described in the next four Sargas from 16 to 19. Now, let me again bring you back to one more point. Let me remind you one more point. So when we were discussing Kumara Sambhava, you must have I would have told you about a particular Loka Katha, a very famous story called Asti Kashchit Vagvisheshaha. So, I told you about the story. So, you can go back to Kumara Sambhava's first video and you'll come to know what's the story behind this. So, we had seen that Kumara Sambhava started with Asti. Asti Tarasyam Dishidevatatma Himalayonama Nagadhirajaha Purva Paroto Yenidivagahya Stitha Prithivya Ivamana Dandaha. So, now that was the Mahakavya describing or starting with Asti. Now, Raghuvamsham, this particular Mahakavya starts with the word Vak. So, among Asti, Kashchit and Vak, we have already discussed Asti and Raghuvamsham is the Kriti, Mahakavya starting with Vak. So, I will first recite the Mangala. So, the every first shloka is called Mangala Charana. That is, a good start is what is the first shloka. And this first shloka of Raghuvamsha is a very beautiful shloka and I would appreciate if you can memorize it. So this goes like this. Vagartha viva sampraktau vagartha pratipattaye jagataha pitarau vande parvati parameshwarau. Beautiful shloka written by Kalidasa wherein he tells vak. Vak is nothing but speech or words. Artha. Artha is meaning. So what he's telling is vak artha iva. So meaning and words, how they are intermingled. That is meaning is told by words and word signifies meaning. In this way, how word and artha meaning complement each other, that couple, ideal couple, Shiva and Parvati, who complement each other like meaning and words and who are also the father and mother of the entire world, Jagata Pitaro, who are the parents for the entire world, to them I salute Vande. So, Vagartha Viva Sampraktav. Sampraktav is who are intermingled or who complement each other. Shiva and Parvati who complement each other, similar to how meaning and words complement each other, and who are also Jagata Pitaro, the parents of the entire world, Vande, I salute. Why do I salute? Vagartha Pratipattaye, so that I can write words which have exact meaning. So you should understand one thing. When you're speaking, as even in Kumar Sambhava, I've told you, Kalidasa always stresses, choose the right words when you're talking. So he's telling that. So let us say you're speaking to someone. It should not be like you're speaking with something in your mind. The meaning in your mind is different. But because of the usage of words, the person who is listening gets the other meaning. So that should not happen. So hence, Kalidasa is praying to Shiva and Parvati, telling that, please bestow me with such words, such vocabulary, so that I can completely make the listener understand my meaning. Whatever I intend to say, the listener should also get the same meaning in such a way. Oh, Shiva and Parvati, give me knowledge, is what Kalidasa has started this beautiful Raghuvamsha with, this beautiful shloka. Vagartha viva sampraktau, vagartha pratipattaye, jagataha pitaro vande, Parvati parameshwarau. Now, I will go back to the statement that I made earlier. So, previously I had made a statement that Raghuvamsha is probably the first Mahakavya of Kalidasa. And I told that I will tell you the reasons for that later. So, now I will tell you the reasons. okay, when you're writing, so Mahakavya is a very challenging thing to do, and Kalidasa has taken up this challenge. So whenever, let us say, if, you know, you're taking up a challenge for the first time, you're always humble because you're scared. You're doing something that you've never done before. So you're always scared about how you will achieve it or how the process will go. Will it be a smooth process? Will you face difficulties? Will people support you? Will people like what you're doing? So you'll have all this fear. Kalidasa also has this fear because this is the first shloka. In the next few shlokas, Kalidasa tells several shlokas which give you the indication that this is the first time that Kalidasa is writing a Mahakavya. For example, the first two classes, the first one or two classes will be very lengthy because the sargas till Rama comes to power is actually very elaborate. After that, Ramayana we know, so that's probably a very short story. So I'll take some time because the shlokas here are very important. So Kalidasa starts off his Mahakavya in a very good start. So he tells, Kwasurya prabhavo vamshaha kwachalpa vishaya matihi titishu dustaram mohat udupenasmi sagaram. He's telling, Kwasurya prabhavo vamshaha, where is that Surya Vamsha which is so great? Kwacha alpa vishaya matihi, and where am I, this limited intellectual poet? So I don't have that much of knowledge, and I am trying to describe a Vamsha that is so great. How is this comparison? How is he comparing this to titishu, the desire to cross what? Dustaram sagaram. So it is me with such a limited knowledge, me trying to explain such a great, glorious Vamsha like Surya Vamsha is like trying to cross a vast and dangerous ocean with what? Udupena. Udupa is a very small boat, like how you row, the rowing boat. He's saying that trying to describe Raghu Vamsha with my limited knowledge is like trying to cross a vast and dangerous ocean with just a small boat. Udupena. Titirshuhu, the desire to cross the ocean with a small boat. So that is how he is comparing. He is telling that I am incapable of doing that, I feel, is what he is telling. Again, further he tells, Mandaha kavihi yashav prarthi gamishyam yupahasyatam pramshulambhe phale lobhat udbahuriva vamanaha. Further, Mandaha kavihi, I am a very foolish poet. But what am I expecting? Yashav Prathi, I intend to become very famous. So I'm trying to write a Mahakavya to attain fame. But I know that I am a very foolish poet. So if I try to write a Mahakavya, how is it? Gamishyami upahasyatam. It will surely become a point of mockery. It will become, everybody will start laughing at this foolish venture or this foolish attempt. Everybody will start laughing. How is it? Again, upama kalidasasya. Kalidasa is famous for a simile. So at every point, if you see, he's trying to give similes. He's giving a simile telling that Vamanaha, a short person, let us say there is a short person, and he sees a fruit hanging very high from a tree. Phale lobhat, in order to get that fruit from the tree, he tries to jump. He does not understand that fruit is beyond his reach, but still he will try jumping higher till he gets that fruit, and he will surely not achieve that. But still, what will the people looking at him do? They will start laughing at him. They'll understand that this fruit is, you know, very far away from the reach of this short guy, but still he is trying to reach that goal. Similarly, me trying to write this Mahakavya about Raghu Vamsha, I will surely be mocked at by others because I am a foolish poet and I am trying to do something that is beyond my reach. So from these few shlokas, again, he'll tell, Athava Krata, by these two shlokas only, you should understand that he's first only accepting that this is his first time. So if the people don't like his work or if it does not turn out to be as good as he expected, then please forgive me because this is my first attempt. So this itself tells you that this Mahakavya Raghu Vamsha is the first attempt of Kalidasa. Further, he's telling that Athava Kritavag Dware Vamshesmin Purva Suri Bihi Madau Vajra Samutkirino Sutra Sevasti Mematihi. Finally, he tells, okay, I understand that whatever task I've decided to do of writing a Mahakavya is probably very difficult. But Purva Suribihi, so there have been people in the past who have greatly described this Vamsha. So people before me have come and described Raghu Vamsha with a lot of panditya. Hence, I feel that because of the knowledge that they've already given, I feel that my task will be simple. Again, Upama Kalidasasya, he'll give another simile. He tells that if pearls, mano, if there are pearls which are already drilled, so if there is already a hole drilled into the mani, then all I am doing, so all I am doing is just putting a thread through it to make a necklace. He's telling that the difficult task is of making a necklace is to drill that hole properly without breaking the mani. And people who have come before me, they have done this big task of giving details about this Surya Vamsha. They have done the difficult task, and my simple task is use that money or use that knowledge and just pass a thread through it to make a necklace. So he's telling that my knowledge is limited, but surely because of the knowledge that people before me have already given, I'm sure that I will achieve this task for completely. So that is the confidence that he is giving to the reader. Finally, he'll tell a very beautiful shloka, and people who have worked in, like, who have done natakas under Mata will surely be aware of this particular shloka. Tam santah shrotumarhanti sadasad vyakti hetavah hemnah samlakshyate hyagnau vishuddhi shamikapiva. So this beautiful shloka, he tells that tam santah, you are the great people who are masters of mahakavyas. So you great people should surely listen to my kavya and tell what is correct and what is incorrect, because you are the best judge of mahakavyas. Again, Upama Kalidasa, he'll give a beautiful simile that to determine the purity of gold, how you put it in fire to detect how pure it is, similarly, you are the fire who will justify how good or bad my Mahakavya will be. Finally, after all this, you know, prologue that he is telling that, please forgive me, this is my first attempt, please, take my, you know, work, go through it, please tell me what is wrong, how I can improve. After doing all this, he finally starts with his Mahakavya Raghuvamsha. And in the very first few shlokas, he will tell some characteristics of Raghuvamsha kings, which are common to everyone. So everyone who comes in Raghuvamsha has these qualities. So instead of telling for every person, for everyone, whoever he describes Dilipa, instead of repeating whatever the qualities he has described again and again, Kalidasa is very clever. He has, in the very beginning of Raghuvamsha itself, he has given some 2 to 3 shlokas, which describes the common qualities that every Raghuvamsha, be it Rama, be it Dashrata, be it Aja, be it Dilipa, whoever, all of them, some qualities they'll surely have. So he has described that in the first few shlokas. Soham ajanma shuddhanam, aphalodaya karmanam, asamudra kshitishanam, anakaratha vartmanam. So I want to describe this Raghuvamsha. And how are the people, how are the kings of Raghuvamsha? Ajanma shuddhanam, who are born pure. Janma, from birth itself, who are born pure, those types of kings. Aphalodaya karmana, those kings who never stop working until their fruits are born. Aphalodaya, till the fruits of their work is obtained, those kings who never stop working. Asamudra kshitishana, those kings who have ruled very huge lands which are surrounded by oceans. So, if you are ruling a very small kingdom, you will not have Samudra, but if you are ruling a kingdom that is surrounded by all the Samudras, it means that you have covered the entire world. Because only if you are ruling the entire world, will your territory be covered by Samudras. So he's saying, Asamudra Kshitishanam. So those rulers who ruled lands which were always covered by Samudras on all the sides, and Anakarata Vartmana. So those kings were so great that the chariots could even fly till the heaven. Anaka, Naka is heaven. Anakarata Vartmanam. So we have already seen. Dasharatha was able to, you know, we have seen it in several places, like kings on earth were called by devatas to help them fight wars. So these Raghuvamsha kings were also that great, that Anakarata Vartmanam, they were given the power to ride their chariots directly till heaven. So our vehicles don't even cross a proper muddy road, but their greatness is such that their rathas could even reach this, limits of Swarga. So those types of kings is what I'll be describing, is what Kalidasa tells. Yatha vidhi hutagnina, yatha kama chitarthina, yatha paratha dandana. He's telling that yatha vidhi hutagnina. So they are the people who always did yajnas, yagas, and whatever the final purnahuti they gave was complementary to whatever yajna they were doing. So they were never, they were never stingy in their yajna. So if yajna needed enough amount of cows, enough amount of, rice, etc., they were ready to give that. Yatha kamarchit arthinam. So, whatever is their desire, they were ready to put in the efforts in order to achieve that desire. Yatha paratha dandanam. So, if there is a particular mistake that is done, the punishment was complementary or similar to the punishment. So no, there was no excess punishment, there was no very less punishment. The punishment was complementary or equivalent to the crime done. So those types of kings is what I will be describing. Finally, he again beautifully tells, Tyagaya Sampratarthanam Satyaya Mitabhashanam. So Tyagaya Sampratarthanam. So they collected money in order to do charity. They spoke, and whenever they spoke the truth. Yashase Vijigishunam. So they went on missions. They went on successful missions. Like they went on wars. They didn't go to wars to just gain territory. They went there for yashase, for gaining fame. So they didn't fight wars to just do bloodshed or to win over territories. They waged wars to achieve fame. And Prajayai Grahamedhinam. And they entered Grahasthashrama, or they took up Grahasthashrama, or they married. Why did they marry? Prajayai. In order to gain a successor. So he's telling that whatever these Raghuvamsha kings did, they did it for a reason. And that reason was as per their, Rajaniti or whatever is the actual need, they did it for that. So they didn't do it for excess of for their own, or they didn't do it at all. So they did it in the right way. Finally, how were these kings? Shaishave Bhyasta Vidyanam Yauvane Vishayeshinam Bardakye Munivrittinam Yoga Nante Tanum Tyajam. Very beautiful and very apt shloka for Raghuvamsha. He's telling that Shaishave Abhyasta Vidyanam. So at a young age, in their childhood, what did these kings do? Abhyasta Vidyanam. So they educated themselves and they learned what they had to learn, be it Rajavidya, Rajaniti, be it archery, be it warfare, whatever. In their young age, they understood all the knowledge, or they gained all the knowledge. Yauvane, when they became youth, when in their youthful stage, what did they do? Vishayeshinam. So they gained all the Rajanitis, so state affairs. They were engrossed in state affairs when they were young. Vardakye, when they became old, Munivritti Nam, so they took Vanaprastha. And when we discuss Raghuvamsha, this will become more clear that once a king felt that his son was capable enough to rule the kingdom, even if he had enough time to rule, even if he was young enough to rule, they didn't continue. Once they felt that their successor was strong enough to control the entire kingdom, they gave the kingdom to their sons and they went into Vanaprastha. So that is what Kalidasa has mentioned. Vardakye Munivritti Nam. The kings who took Vanaprastha once they reached old age. And finally, Yoge Nante Tanutyajam. And those kings who were capable enough to leave this soul, leave this Sharira, and that Atma that could escape by the means of yoga. That is, they were experts in yoga as well. And these kings were capable of letting go of this or shedding this Sharira and relieving themselves to higher worlds. So those types of kings is what I will be describing, is what Kalidasa tells. So this entire 2 to 3 shlokas that I told is a common characteristic of all the kings who came in Raghuvamsha. Now, Sarga 1 starts again. So this is all still in the Sarga 1 itself, but it is a prologue, introduction to Raghuvamsha. Finally, he tells, Imam Vivasvate Yogam. So he tells, this particular Vamsha started from Surya. And Surya's son, Manu, is the first king of this particular Vamsha, that is Surya Vamsha. Finally, again, he does not go into the detail because his only intention is to describe Raghu Vamsha. Hence, rather than telling every king from Manu, he directly jumps from Manu directly to Dilipa. And he tells that in this particular Vamsha where Manu was born, a particular king who was born, and Tadanvaye Shuddhimati, in this beautiful clan which are consisting of Shuddhimati, pure minds, Prasuta Shuddhimattaraha, was born a more purer form. How was he? Dilipa. His name was Dilipa. Raja Induhu. He was the moon among the kings. So of course, he could have even used Raja Surya, but because it was Surya Vamsha, but again, the reason is given next. Kshira Nidhaviva. So during Samudra Mathana, as Samudra Matana was done, from Samudra arose the Chandra. Similarly, he's telling that in the Kshira Sagara, he's comparing the Surya Vamsha to Kshira Sagara, which is already so great. And from this great Vamsha called Surya Vamsha came out the moon called Dilipa. And again, the common characteristics are again defined. And finally, Kalidasa tells, Akara Sadrasha Pragyaha, Pragyaya Sadrashagamaha, Agamai Sadrasharambhaha, Arambha Sadrashodayaha. Very beautiful shloka, he tells. in the previous shlokas, if you read, of course, I've taken some selective shlokas. So if you read the Raghuvamsha, he'll tell, Kalidasa will tell, so how well built he was. He had a very long arm. He had a very, you know, broad chest. He is, you know, he was a very tall person. So he tells all that. So he, after telling that, he's telling, Akara Sadrisha Prajnaha. So Akara, he has described as Akara. So his physical form is very great. And Akara Sadrisha Prajnaha, his intellect was befitting his physical appearance. So he had a very good appearance, and suitable to that physical appearance, he had similar intellect. Prajnaya sadashagamaha. And similar to his intellect was his panditya. That is his, you know, educational mastery was befitting his prajna, intellect. And agamaihi sadasharambha. And befitting his panditya was his undertaking. So whatever work he started was befitting his panditya. And arambha sadashodayaha. And befitting his undertakings or the works he did was his udaya, his glory. So finally, he's saying that your body is your final goal to reach your udaya, that is your glory. And even in Kumara Sambhava, we discussed when the Shiva in the form of Brahmachari comes and asks Kushalopari, he tells, Shariramadhyam kalu dharma sadhanam. This body is your means of doing dharma. Hence, even here, he's saying he started with Akara, the physical form of Raghu, and finally, he told that. From that Akara, he had similar, very, you know, comparable intellect. Because of that intellect, he could learn all the required Shastras and the Agamas. From his Agama knowledge, he started undertaking very good work or noble work. And because of these undertakings, he was able to achieve very great heights. So he has given a very good chain of events that complement each other. One more thing. So in that time, the tax that we pay today is not a new thing. And tax was being collected even in the types of Raghuvamsha, and that is what even Kalidasa mentions here. Prajanameva bhutyartyam satabhyo bali magrahita sahasraguna mutrashtum adattehi rasam ravihi. So, if a king does not, so let us say Dilipa is a very, you know, strong king, he was able to get enough money from by war, he could have, you know, not taken tax. So that could have been a vada. But in order to involve citizens in Raja, you know, Rajatantra, so in order to involve citizens in ruling the kingdom, he made sure that they are responsible enough to pay the tax. So in order to do them, so prajanameva bhutyartham, in order to do good for the citizens itself, Dilipa collected tax. But how did he collect tax? Very beautifully, Kalidasa mentions that. So we know the sun. So what does the sun do? It will sap all the water from the ground in the form of vapor. And finally, it will shower rain. But if you compare the amount of water it collects from the ground and the amount of rain it showers, it's incomparable. So it collects a very small amount of vapor but gives a large amount of water. Hence, similarly, sahasraguna mutsrashtum, similar to how Surya takes a small amount of water and gives thousands folds of water in the form of rain, Dilipa also collected small amount of tax but gave back in return thousand folds of profit. In some other, it's not money only, in some or the other way, by giving them good protection, by giving them, you know, very good amount of land. So by all these means, he made sure that whatever he collected, he gave back thousandfold back to them. Finally, he again, Kalidasa tells, Sena parichadastasya dvayame vartha sadhanam shastre shvakunthita buddhihi maurvi dhunushi chatata. So being a king, he'll surely have an army. But Kalidasa tells that this army was just a namesake. It was not even necessary. Because dvayame vartha sadhanam, so there was only two means by which Dilipa could gain whatever he wishes. So he could fulfill all his desires because of only two things. What were those two things? Shastreshu akuntita buddhihi, his unparalleled knowledge in the shastras, be it Rajaniti Shastra, be it Yuddha Shastra, be it whatever. Every shastra he was so well versed that whatever he could do, that was one thing. Second thing was maurvi dhanushi chatata. So he is mastery or his skill in archery, that is his warfare skills and his immense or unparalleled knowledge in shastras were the only two necessary things that were necessary. The sena or the army that he had was just a namesake thing. It was not even necessary for him. All he needed was his knowledge and his strength or his skill in warfare. Now, prajana vinayadhanat rakshanad bharanadapi sapita pitarastasam kevalam janmahetava. Very beautifully he tells that prajanam eva bhut prajanam vinayadhana. So being a king, his only, you know, job was not to fight wars and, you know, win territories. His other, the main thing, so Kalidasa tells that as a king, what Dilipa did was vinayadhana. So he taught them vinaya. He taught them humility. Further, Rakshanath, he protected them. Bharanath, he nurtured them. So, Dilipa just did not restrict himself to the palace. He did not stay in the palace. He did not enjoy luxury. He did not go for wars and come back. He went further for improving the citizens. He taught them very important lessons of humility. He protected them and he nurtured them. And finally, he tells, Saha Pita Pitaraha. So, he became the father of the citizens. But the actual parents who gave birth were just parents for namesake because they gave birth. But after that, the parents for all these citizens was Dilipa. Similarly, if you read in Vikramasyavadaryam when we discussed, Raja Bandura Bandhu Naam, Raja Chakshura Chakshusham, Raja Pita Cha Mata Cha, Raja Charti Haro Guruhu. So there only it is told. The king is like the father and mother to the citizens. Similarly, here also, Kalidasa beautifully tells that because of his lessons of humility, because of his protection, because of his nurturing, the citizens, he became the father for the citizens and the parents were just a namesake parent because they had given birth. Now, this Dilipa, not just Dilipa, but any king, king of Surya Vamsha was always a very generous person. He gave enough, large amounts of charity. He did a large amount of dana, everything. So, very beautifully, Kalidasa mentions, Tasya dakshinya rudhena namna magadha vamshaja patni sudakshine tyasat advarasyeva dakshina. So, dakshinya rudha. So, this Dilipa was very generous. So, that's why he has used dakshinya rupa, dakshinya rudha. So, a person who has taken up dakshinya, that is charity to a very high level. So, for that person, so for that type of Dilipa, the wife was called Sudakshina. So, just to bring in the name of Sudakshina, our Kavi Kalidasa beautifully tells that Raghu was a dakshinya rudha, a person who had done large amount of charity, and similar to him, he married a princess of Magadha Vamsha called Sudakshina, who herself was a reincarnation of Dakshinya, charity. So he has used Dakshina, Dakshinya, Sudakshina, all these names again and again. It's called Anuprasalankara, wherein you repeat letters or you repeat words to improve the or increase the beauty of the shloka. So Raghu Dilipa, who was known for his charity, married a lady called Sudakshina, who was herself a reincarnation of Dakshina. Again, Kalatravantam Atmanam Avarodhe Mahatyapi Tayamene Manasvinya Lakshmiyacha Vasudhadipaha. So, Dilipa considered himself to be married only because of two wives. So, Rajaha Bhovallabha. So, you will probably know this. So, kings in those times were known to marry a lot of women. Even Raghu had, sorry, Dilipa had married a lot of, queens. But he considered himself married only because of two queens. One was her Pattaragni, that is the Maharagni Sudakshina. And second wife that he considered is Rajalakshmi, that is the prosperity. Beautifully, Kalidasa has mentioned that Raghu Dilipa considered Rajalakshmi to be so prominent that he even considered himself to be married because of only two wives. One is his main queen, Sudakshina, and other one is because of Rajalakshmi. So, having described Dilipa in this way, now Kalidasa comes to one of the most important incidents in the life of Dilipa. So, even though Dilipa has seen such a lot of prosperity, such a lot of, success in his tenure, he's issueless. So, he does not have a child. So, in order to find a solution, he and Sudakshina go to Rishi, the Kulaguru Vashishta. So, Vashishta is the Kulaguru of Surya Vamsha. So, they go to Kulaguru. So, when they reach there, so, as I've told you, Kalidasa always gives a lot of prominence to Kushalopari. That is the well-being that you ask. So whenever you meet someone, you ask them, so how are you? Is everything well? Are all of you healthy? And then if you're a student, they'll ask you, is your studies going well? So all these happen. So that Kushalopari, Kalidasa gives a lot of prominence. Similarly, even in this meeting, when Sudakshina and Dilipa go to Vashishta and his wife Arundhati, so there also the Kushalopari occurs. So Vashishta asks, so is everything fine? Is all the citizens happy? Everything he asks. So Dilipa tells it, yes, by your grace, thank you, everything is fine. But finally, after telling that everything is fine, Dilipa beautifully tells, Kintu vadhva tavaitasyaha adishta sadrisha prajam. But this, so for the Kulaguru, the king itself is a son. So for Vashishta, Dilipa itself is a son. So he tells, so I am your son, and this Vadhu, this daughter-in-law that you have, that is Sudakshina, Adrishta Prajam, that is, she does not have a son. So, that is the main problem. And how can you not see this? So, how can you, being the guru, kula guru of our vamsha, not have observed that your daughter-in-law Sudakshina is issueless? Then he again tells, lokantara sukham punyam tapodana samudbhavam santati shuddha vamshya hi paratrehana paratrena sharmane. So he tells that why he is giving so much of prominence. As I've told you, I know getting a successor is important. I had mentioned you in the initial point also. And so again, at this point of time, Dilipa beautifully mentions that by doing tapaha dana, by doing tapas, penance and charity, you gain enough amount of punya for this loka. But if you have a good son born into a good vamsha, then not just this life, but your next life or your next loka, this loka and the next loka also will be purified. So after having heard this, then Vasishta closes his eyes for a short amount of time to see what has occurred. So what is the reason for this problem? He closes his eyes and meditates, and then he finally opens.
Anna, Anna, can I tell the thing?
Okay, yeah, you can tell. Yes.
Anna, because one cow was there named Surabhi.
Okay, that's a different
story. That cow got
So that's a different story. Kalidasa again probably has taken a different approach. So yeah, Surabhi does not come in Raghuvamsha. So in Raghuvamsha's terms, I'll tell you the story. So probably the actual story might be what they're telling about Surabhi. So here what happens in Raghuvamsha is, so Vasishta tells that, you know, as I've told you, Anakarata Vartmana, the kings of Raghuvamsha were, you know, regular visitors to Swarga. So during one of these visits, even, you know, Dilipa would have gone to meet Indra. But while coming back, he would be in a very, he would be in a hurry. So there is actually this Kamadhenu. So Kamadhenu is the, this thing, the cow of the Swarga. So that is there under the shade of Kalpataru. So Kalpavriksha is also the tree in Swarga. So this, you know, Kamadhenu is standing in the shade of that tree. But Raghu, in, you know, Dilipa, while coming back in a hurry, he does not observe that. And he does not go and salute or, you know, do the puja to Kamadhenu. And he just comes down back to his kingdom. So having heard this, what happens is this Kamadhenu gets very angry. So she'll curse, you know, this Dilipa telling that avajanasi mam yanmat atastena bhavishyati matprasuti manadhya rajeti tvam shashapasa. So what he, Vasishta will tell this, that you, O Dilipa, who neglected me and went away from here, will surely not, will be issueless until when mat prasuti manaradhya. If you, until you worship my prasuti, my next child or my calf, until you worship my calf or my next child, you will not be born, you will not be blessed with a child, is what this Kamadhenu would have cursed Dilipa. But what would have happened is, when he is coming back and when the shapa is being given, Airavata, who is the, you know, the elephant of Indra, is also making a lot of noise, and the chariot of Dilipa is also making a lot of noise. So in the in this commotion, Dilipa would not have listened to this curse. So without knowing anything, he would have come back to the earth. So now, now this Vasishta tells that, okay, this was the problem. So now they need a solution. So what this thing Vasishta will tell is, see, you should have actually gone and asked forgiveness from Kamadhenu. But what has happened is, Kamadhenu has been taken away for some yajna. So for some yajna, someone has taken Kamadhenu and she will not return for a very long time. So for several years, she has to be there for the completion of that yajna. And till that point of time, you will not be able to meet Kamadhenu. So as an alternative, Vasishta will tell that you make a murti or you make a statue of Kamadhenu, worship that, and then you should worship. So as you know, Kamadhenu herself has told that until you know worship my child, and the child of Kamadhenu is nothing but Nandini, which is the how, you know, cow that is at Vasishta's ashrama. So Vasishta will tell that, create a statue of Kamadhenu, worship that, and then finally worship Nandini, who is nothing but the daughter of Kamadhenu. So this is the solution given by Vasishta. So now, finally, what, you know, he tells, so Vasishta tells what are the tasks that I have to do. So it's not just like worshipping. The task is very severe, and he tells that, Banya Vrittirimam Shashwat Atmananugamenaga Vidyamarabhyasanena Prasadayitu Marhasi. So he tells that, similar to how a student gains knowledge by reading, you will also gain whatever you desire by serving this cow. Finally, he tells that, Prasthitayam प्रतिष्ठायां प्रतिष्ठेथाः स्थितायां स्थितमाचरेः निषण्णायां निषीदास्यां पीताम्भसि पिबेरपः. सो हि डज दट प्रस्थितायां प्रतिष्ठेतः. सो इफ दट कौ मूव्स यू मूव. स्थितायां स्थितिमाचरेः. इफ दट कौ स्टॉप्स यू स्टॉप. निषण्णायां निषीदास्यां. इफ दट कौ सिट्स डाउन यू सिट डाउन. पीताम्भसि पिबेरपः. इफ दट कौ ड्रिंक्स वाटर ओनली देन विल यू ड्रिंक वाटर. सो दिस इज द अमाउंट ऑफ tasks, or this is the severity of the task. So whatever Nandini does, he should follow. Wherever it goes, he should follow. That is what Guru Vasishtha tells. Finally, listening to the words of Vasishtha, both of them, Sudakshina as well as Dilipa, they agreed to do that. And the Sudakshina's part is this much. So in the morning, when the Nandini is going out for grazing, she should do the puja in the morning. And worship Nandini, and she should follow Nandini until it enters into the forest. So till that border of the forest, Sudakshina should accompany Dilipa as well as Nandini. And once they cross the forest, she should come back. But in the evening, when Nandini is coming back, she should go and always be waiting at the border to welcome Nandini back. So this is the job of Sudakshina, and the job of Dilipa is you should follow Nandini. If it moves, you move. If it sits, you sit. If she drinks water, will you drink water? So at this time, having told all these tasks that have to be done, Dilipa let go of all his ornaments. So he's come as a Raja to ask for a solution. But listening to what the task he has to do, Dilipa decides that, okay, I don't need these ornaments. I don't need anything. So he'll give all the ornaments away. He'll put the kingdom in charge of the ministers, and he'll come and he will wear those bark garments, and he will reside, or he will come and sit at, he'll come and sleep at Vasishtha's ashrama on the bed of Kusha grass. So finally, they decide to worship. So this is the end of first sarga, wherein the first sarga has ended with Dilipa coming to know the cause and the solution of what is the problem of him being issueless and how he has agreed to do the task. So quickly going to sarga 2. So sarga 2, as again, instructed by Vasishtha, so Dilipa and Sudakshina start doing the tasks. Again, beautifully Kalidasa mentions. So in the first sarga, Vasishtha has told what has to be done. That, you have to, if she sits, you sit. If she walks, you walk. So all this he has told. So now, again, Kalidasa tells, Sthitaha sthitaam uchalitah prayatam nishedishim asana baddhadhiraha jalabhilashi jalamadadhanam chayevatam bhupatiranvagachyat. So that king, Dilipa, who mooed when the cow mooed, who sat down when the cow sat down, who drank water when the cow drank water, started following the cow, chayeva, similar to how a shadow follows you. A shadow always follows you. Wherever you go, it follows. Similarly, even the king started going behind the Nandini and doing the tasks. And when he came to Vasishtha's ashrama, there were some of his soldiers who had come along with him for protection. But Dilipa is a very strong king. So what he does is he sends back his soldiers saying that, I don't need your help here. I have to do this on my own. And he sends back the soldiers as well. He is dressed in a bark garment, as I've told you, with no ornaments. And he just has one bow in his hand for protecting Nandini. And when they enter the forest on the very first day. So on the very first day, Kalidasa gives some detailed explanation of what happens. And beautifully, he again, as I've told you, Kalidasa is a Prakriti Kavi. So he gives a very beautiful description of what is happening in the forest. So he tells that once they enter, what is happening is flowers are falling on him. Then deers, even though he's holding a bow and arrow, the deers are not scared because they know Dilipa is a just ruler. He is simply not hunt. So even they stand and stare at the beautiful, picture that is in front of them. There is this auspicious cow, Nandini, who is going. And behind it is this great king, Dilipa, who is going. So even the deers are standing and seeing. And the wind, Marut, who is, blowing, he also, in order to soothe the exhaustion. So Dilipa has, feels tired after doing this. So in order to soothe his exhaustion, even it starts playing music. And in the evening, when they come back, Sudakshina is waiting to worship Nandini at the entrance of the forest. So at the entrance of the ashrama itself, Sudakshina is waiting and she does the puja. And Nandini is actually, being a cow, it also has a calf. And it also wants to. So since morning till evening, it has been away from the calf, but still it waits patiently until Sudakshana completes her puja, and then she goes immediately to feed her calf. Now, beautifully at this point of time, when Sudakshana is waiting to do the puja, the Nandini has come, and behind Nandini is our King Dilipa. A beautiful scenery is created by Kalidasa. Puraskrita Vartmani Parthivena Pratyudgata Parthiva Dharma Patnya Tadantaresa Viraraja Dhenuhu Dinakshapa Madhyagateva Sandhya. So, in front of Nandini is Sudakshana, who is eager to do the puja, and behind Nandini is our King Dilipa. So, in between Sudakshana and Dilipa is the auspicious cow Nandini, and again, Upama, the simile given by Kalidasa is beautiful. Similar to how Sandhya Kala is beautiful between day and night, this particular picture of Nandini in between Sudakshana and Raghu is being described. So, Nandini standing in between Sudakshana and Raghu is similar to Sandhya Kala that arrives in between day and night. So now, after all this is done, so after the puja is done, Nandini goes and feeds the calf. So Dilipa comes, salutes Vasishta, and again, immediately, they don't take rest. Immediately, they go and they start serving. So it's night. So they do start their night service. That is, they spread out the grass. They make Nandini sleep on that. They blow away the flies that are trying to bite or, you know, sit on Nandini's skin. So they do all this. So they don't take rest. Until Nandini sleeps and she's, you know, comfortable, they don't rest. So, and beautifully, again, Kalidasa tells that. So they sleep in one order and they wake up in the opposite order. So what happens is, first, Nandini sleeps. Seeing Nandini sleep, Guru Vasishta goes and, you know, sleeps. Then after the, you know, Vasishta has slept, Dilipa sleeps. And once Dilipa has slept, Sudakshana will sleep. But while waking up, first Sudakshana wakes up, then Dilipa wakes up, then Vasishta wakes up, and finally Nandini wakes up. So beautifully, So he has beautifully mentioned that they sleep in one order and they get up in the opposite order in order to be ready to serve Nandini as well as Guru Vasishta. Yes, Kalidasa has taken time to explain one day because the next day will be the same. And finally he tells, Itham vrita bharayata prajartham samam mahishya mahaniya kirtehe saptatyuti trigunani tasya dinani dino dharana chita tasya tasya. So he tells that in this way, that King Dilipa, who is the king of the citizens, what he does is, he serves Nandini for saptatyuti trigunaha, that is 7 days into three, that is 21 days. For 21 days, Dilipa thus, you know, properly serves Nandini. He has described these 21 days. Under the 22nd day, what happens is, similarly, as usual, they leave from the ashram of Vasishta and they enter. But this time, what Nandini decides is, Nandini enters into a cave in the Himalayas. So, there are Kalidasa tells, normal cows, the cowherd who is coming along with them, he will tell where the cow will graze. So, he will, you know, make the cow move in the desired direction. But here, Dilipa does not do that. Wherever Nandini goes, he goes. So, this time around, on this 22nd day, what happens is, Nandini decides to go and graze near a cave in the Himalayas. Why she chooses that place is, there is a waterfall of Ganga, and because of that waterfall of Ganga, that place has been filled with green, that is foliage. So it has a lot of grass to graze. So Nandini chooses that spot. So it goes and starts eating that grass in that cave in the Himalayas. So having served Nandini for 21 days, now Dilipa is well acquainted. So he knows, okay, this is what Nandini will do. So at this time, she will need water. So at this time, we'll have to go back. So he is very, and he has understood the daily routine. So now he's not that careful about looking after. So on the first day, we have seen Chayeva Sa Anugachat. So he went like a shadow, but now he knows, okay, Nandini, so this is what will happen. So yeah, so this time, if I know, I can do this. So what happens is, when he comes to Himalayas, he starts, you know, observing the beauty of the Himalayas, how these trees have bloomed, how these flowers have bloomed. So he starts observing the scenic beauty and shifts his concentration from Nandini for a small moment. And at this point of time, a lion comes and attacks Nandini. And Nandini screams for help. And immediately, Dilipa, who had momentarily shifted his concentration, immediately looks towards Nandini. And he enters into the cave. So in the cave, so the screaming of Nandini echoes and, you know, gives that dual sound effect to Dilipa, who runs into the cave to see what has happened. And when she enters into the cave, he sees that there is a lion who is ready to kill Nandini, and Dilipa is very angry that someone is trying to kill Guru Vasishtha's cow, so he's ready to kill it. And he goes and tries to remove an arrow from his quiver. So the quiver is what, you know, is behind, so you have arrows in that. So he goes and reaches for an arrow. And at that point of time, what happens is, Vametarastasya kara prahartahu nakaprabha bhushita kankapatre saktangulihi sayaka panka eva chitrarpitarambha ivavatasthe. Once he touches his arrow, so again, Pankapatra. So Kankapatra is the feather. So the, you know, arrows have the feathers for the king to hold or any archer to hold. So once he holds the arrow at that Kankapatra, at that feather, his hand stops. It stupefies. So he can't move his hand anymore. And again, beautifully Kalidasa tells that it is as though. So now the Kalidasa, you know, Dilipa is unable to move at all. So he has touched his arrow and that's it. He can't move anymore. And Kalidasa tells that it is as though someone has painted a picture of an archer trying to remove an arrow from his quiver. So he has stopped. Now, first of all, he is angry that some lion is coming and attacking Nandini. Second of all, he is even more angry that he is helpless, that he can't help anyone. So he is even more angrier and his eyes become very red. Then, to the surprise of Dilipa, the lion starts speaking in the voice of a human being. And he tells, Alam mahipala tavashramena prayuktamapyastramito vrathasya napadapon moolana shaktiramha shilochaye mochati marutasya. So he tells, Alam mahipala, O king, stop your efforts. Don't put even more efforts. Tavashramena alam. Enough of your efforts. Prayuktamapyastramito vrathasyat. Even if you were, you know, to shoot this arrow at me, vrathasyat, it would surely have gone waste. Why? Similar to how padapon moolana shakti ramha. Wind is powerful enough to uproot trees. So, just because a wind is able to uproot trees, it should not try to think that it can uproot mountains. So, similarly, even you, even if you were able to move your hand and shoot this arrow, it surely would have not affected me and it would have gone in vain. This is a very prominent shloka of Raghuvamsha. Alam mahipala tavashramena prayuktamapyastramito vrathasyat napadapon moolana shakti ramha shilochaye mochati marutasya. So now, having told all this, the lion continues. Kailasa gauram vrishamaru rukshoho padarpananu grahaputa prishtam avehimam kinkaramashta murtehe Kumbodharam naam ani kumbhamitram. So he introduces himself. So he has started speaking in a human voice. So surely he knows that Dilipa is curious to know who this lion is. So what he tells is, Kailasa Gauram. So that master of Kailasa, that ruler of Kailasa, Shiva, who in order to get on top of Nandi, his Vahana, steps on me. Padarpana anugraha puta prishthe. So I am that lion on whom Shiva steps on to climb onto his Nandi. And I have been purified by it. Puta prishtam. That is purified by that touch of his foot. And avehi, know me, or I am that person. Who am I? Kumbodharam. I am Kumbodhara. And further, who am I? Nikumbha Mitram. I am the friend of Nikumbha. Who is this Nikumbha? Nikumbha is the lion, which is the Vahana of Parvati. So Parvati's Vahana is a lion. And that lion's name is Nikumbha. And I am that Kumbhodara, who is a friend of Nikumbha. He introduces himself. Now, Amum Purah. So he again tells, why is he here? So he has introduced himself. Now he is telling why he has come to this particular spot. Amum Purah Pashyati Devadarum Putri Krutosau Vrishabhadvajena. So he is telling that, now see in front of you. In front of you, you see a Devadaru tree. So a deer wood is what you call in English. So this Devadaru tree, do you see? So this particular tree has been considered as a child by Parvati. So in Kumara Sambhava also we have seen, once Parvati came to do tapas, the first thing she did is she planted trees and she, you know, nurtured them similar to her children. Similarly, even in Raghuvamsham also he tells that this particular Devadaru tree has been considered by Mata Parvati as her son itself. And she has nurtured it very well. But what happened is, one point of time, an elephant came into this region and its head was feeling itchy. So it went and rubbed its head on this Devadaru tree and one of the branches broke and fell down. Now, just by seeing a branch of this tree broken down, Parvati felt very sad. And how has she felt very sad? Similar to how she would feel sad when Kartikeya would have been hurt in war. She had that much of, you know, sadness when that elephant broke one of the branches. Hence, Shiva, in order to protect this Devadaru tree, has appointed me at this point. And further, I have been ordered by Shiva. So since I have to protect this tree, I can't go anywhere else. Hence, in order to, you know, look after my food, Shiva has granted me the boon that any animal that comes into this part of the Himalayas, I can without any, you know, problem, I should be able to eat it so that I can perform the duty of protecting this Devadaru tree. So he does it. So I am that Nikumbha and I've been appointed to protect this tree. Now, now the king is already very sad and he tells that, please, and further, the, you know, the lion will tell. So, oh Dilipa, see, you can't do anything. You can't help this Nandini or this cow for any, by any means. So what I will tell is, so you just go back to your place and don't worry about this cow. She is now my food. And he also tells that, see, if you're worried that you could not protect it, don't worry. Because Shastrena Rakshyam Yada Shastra Raksham Natad Yasha Shastra Bhratam Kshanoti. So he tells that, see, I know if you're a Nakshatriya, it's your duty to protect someone. And if someone, something can be protected by Astra, then sure you should protect it. But this situation is such that you cannot protect even with any Astra, because in the initial, this thing only he has told, Vrtha Syat. So he already told that there, his Astras would be ineffective. So he's telling that if there's a situation wherein you can't protect someone by Astra, then it is not the fault of the archer, because the situation is such that he can't use his efforts. So don't worry, you won't, you know, achieve any bad, you know, reputation because of this. So please, you go back. So now Dilipa tells that, see, okay, you also have to understand, O Nikumbha, that see, you have been appointed by Shiva to protect this Devadaru tree. Similarly, I have been appointed by Guru Vasishtha to protect this cow. So please let go of this cow. Further, how is this Nandini? She is a mother of a child, and that calf is waiting eagerly since morning for her mother to return so that she can drink her milk. So such a type of Nandini, please don't harm her. So please let go of her. And he tells, Sattvam Madiyena Sharira Vrittim. So please exchange her body with mine. That is, you let go of Nandini. Please, you know, take me as your food and please let go of this Nandini. Listening to this, Kumbhodara laughs and he tells, oh, Dilipa, so Ekata Patram, you are a monarch. You are ruling over the entire world. Jagata Prabhutvam, you have the control over the entire world. Navam Vayaha, you have youth. Kantamidam Vapushcha, you have a very radiant body. So you have so many good qualities and so many things that you have in you. But Alpasya Hetaho, just because of one small thing, that is just to protect a small thing like this Nandini, Bahuhatu Michan, you are trying to say, you know, you want to sacrifice so much. Vichara Modha Pratibhasi Metvam. So listening to this, so you have so many things that you have, but still just for one cow, you are ready to let go of all this. Now I feel that you are a foolish king. Vichara Modha, I feel that you are a very foolish person. Now the, you know, the king will again take the word Kshatriya comes on. Kshatat Trayate Iti Kshatriyaha, the one who protects the people or the, you know, people from fear or danger is called Kshatriya. So you have to know that a Kshatriya is a person who should protect. So if I am not able to protect this cow, Nandini, then this body of mine is waste. I don't have any use because as a Kshatriya, I failed in my duty. Hence, I feel that since my body is already a waste, you should surely take my this thing body and leave this cow Nandini. Now, even in Kumara Sambhava, I had mentioned, once that Brahmin, the Shiva in the form of Brahmachari, comes and starts speaking with Parvati, he tells, oh Parvati, you have spoken for such a long time, so we have become friends. So here also, that's what Kalidasa's Shaili is, that his style of writing itself is like that, that once two strangers start speaking for some amount of time, they become as close as friends or even relatives. So he tells, Dilipa tells, oh Kumbhodara, we have been speaking for such a long time, so we are like friends now. So please understand this. I am not worried about this physical body. Yashashareere bhavame dayaluhu. See, don't worry about this physical body. I am not worried about it. But I'm worried about Yashakaya. We have seen even in Subhashita. Jayantite Sukritino Rasasiddha Kavishwaraha Nasitesham Yashakaya Jaramanajam Bhayam. So he's telling that Dilipa is saying that, see, I'm not worried about the physical body, but I'm worried about the fame. If I, you know, if I listen to your words and run away from here, then my entire Vamsha, Surya Vamsha itself will have a bad remark that a king of the Surya Vamsha let go of his duties and ran away. Hence, Yashakaya me dayalu bhava. So please become, you know, generous and please protect my Yashakaya, my body of fame. I'm not worried about the physical body. Protect my body of fame. So because of that, please let me protect this Nandini and you can take my body. So now, after having listened to this, the lion tells, okay, you are a foolish king. So whatever, okay, finally, what is it? My food should be given to me. So now that, okay, I tried persuading you, telling that you are a foolish person, you should not let go of your, you know, kingdom, your citizens, etc. Okay, if you are ready to let go of all that, I don't care. Okay, fine, I'll accept your offer. So once he told this, Dilipa's stupefied body, that, you know, body that was stuck in one position, it became free. So, you know, if it was any other person, probably he would have, you know, just, you know, once his body was free, he would have tried to shoot an arrow. But Dilipa is a person who, once he gives his word, he follows it. So once he gave his word that, okay, I will give my body to you, he did not, once his body became free, he just put down his weapons and put his head down. And told, you know, he surrendered himself, ready to be consumed by the lion. But at that point of time, tasminikshane palayituhu prajanam utpashyata simhanipata mugram avangmukhasyopari pushpavrishtihi papata vidyadhara hastamukta. So I'm very happy that my name has come in this Mahakavya. But the thing is, now Raghu is waiting, Dilipa is waiting for the lion to eat him. But tasminikshane, in that time, what happens is, avangmukhasyopari, so he's now bent his head, so he's not seeing what is happening. So he has put his head down and he's waiting. Papata pushpavrishtihi tasyopari. So on top of him, no, the flowers were showered by whom? Vidyadhara. So Vidyadharas are nothing but demigod. They are a clan of demigods, like how you have Yakshas, Kimpurushas, Kinnaras, etc. Even Vidyadharas are a particular group of demigods. So they shower flowers on Dilipa. So once this happens, then Nandini tells, oh Dilipa, all this was just a test that I was doing to test your commitment and your devotion. So I'm very happy that you did this. So please ask for any boon. So then he, you know, Dilipa, he could have asked for any boon, but of course, at this point of time, Dilipa's only, as I've told you, Raghuvamsha's rulers never ask for anything more than what they want. So he asks, Vamshasya Kartaram Anantakirtim Sudakshinayam Tanayam Yayache. At that point of time, what did he ask? Vamshasya Kartaram, that is the successor for the Vamsha, Anantakirtim. So not just any king, you know, not just any son, Anantakirtim. So even, you know, this comes in every part of mythology. When Shiva Guru was asked by Shiva, do you want a brilliant son who will give you fame for a very short time, or do you want a foolish son who will live for a very long time? Shiva Guru was intelligent enough that he chose the first option. That is an intelligent son who is even for a short time. Because only Suvichakshana Sutaha, even in Subhashitas we have seen, Suvichakshana Sutaha, only a good or intelligent son is what is needed. Hence, even he will ask Anantakirtim, a son who will bring lot of fame to the Vamsha, Sudakshinayam, born from Sudakshina, Tanayam Yayacha, he asked for a king. Sorry, he asked for a son born to Sudakshina. So, having, when, you know, Dilipa asks for this boon, Nandini tells, yes, as you wish. And she tells it, drink the milk that comes from me and your wish should be fulfilled. But see, if there was any other person, he would have taken the opportunity to immediately take the milk. But Dilipa did not do that. What he told is, okay, thank you, but first we will go back to the ashrama, let Sudakshina do your puja, we will talk with Vasishta, take his blessings, and then first you feed your calf, because your calf has been waiting. Whatever you are giving me, it can wait, but your calf should not wait. So first feed your calf, and whatever is remaining, that milk I will consume. So beautifully, you should understand how Kalidasa has understood Raghuvamsha, and how even Raghuvamsha actually was. So in this beautiful way, they come back to the ashrama, Sudakshina performs the puja, Dilipa goes and salutes Vasishta and Arundhati, takes their blessings, and once the calf has been fed, Dilipa consumes the milk and goes back to the kingdom. So he has come out of his kingdom for this time. So he again goes back to his kingdom, takes up the, you know, Rajadharma, and at that point of time, this second sarga ends with Atha Nayana Samuttham Jyotiritreva Ridyoho Surasa Diva Tejo Vahni Nishtyuta Naisham Narapati Kulabhutyam Garbhamadatta Ragni Guru Bhi Abhivishtam Lokapalanu Bhurvam. So what he tells is, at this point of time, once King Dilipa comes and retakes his, you know, kingdom, like from his ministers, Sudakshina bears a child. And how is this bearing a child? Similar to how Atri bore a a sun called Chandra, who had so much of aura, or similar to how Ganga bore the Kartikeya, the son of Shiva and Parvati in her, similarly, Sudakshina bore a very brilliant and glowing child who will be called Raghu, who will be born into the Vamsha of Raghu. So in this way, second sarga ends. So we will end today's class here. So we have completed just first two sargas. But as I've told you, the problem with Mahabharata and Raghu Vamsha is, in Mahabharata also, Adiparva, it starts with Shantanu and it ends with the coronation of Yudhishthira. So it is a very long parva. But after that, the story moves quickly from each parva to parva. Similarly, the first 5 to 6 parvas are a very important and detailed explanation will be given. But after that, the story from Rama is a very common thing. So from there, we will jump quickly. So probably 2 more classes I will take. So with this, we will end Raghu Vamsha's first class, that is the first 2 sargas. So if you have any doubts, you can ask, or else we can conclude today's meeting. I'm taking a lot of time because I want you to understand Raghu Vamsha more. So please bear with me for these 3-4 classes, and after that probably 2 to 3 classes for the remaining 2. So we'll probably end Sukti Ratnani with that, and we'll go back to our regular curriculum. Okay. Okay. So we'll conclude today's class.
But it's very interesting to know stories.
Yeah, that is my intention, that you should know these stories, because in Ramayana Mahabharata you may not find these intricate stories. It's usually not given. So it's better you hear it from Kalidasa, because Valmiki, his job was to give the world the first Adikavya, and that was his job, and he gave it in a very beautiful way. But now Kalidasa, since he has a lot more time, he has a lot more panditya, he takes some time to not just give you the story, but to beautify the story and give it to you.
True.
Okay. So with that, we'll conclude today's class. So, Guru Reva Gatihi Guru Meva Bhaje Guru Neiva Sahasmi Namo Gurave Na Guru Paramam Shishurasmi Guru Ormatirasti Guru Mama Pahi Guru Ram Ram Ram.